expected back round about this year. Now, Swift Tuttle is associated with the brilliant Perseid meteor shower, which you see in the first fortnight of every August. And you'd expect the meteor shower to be at its best when Swift Tuttle is near. Now, the Perseids were exceptionally plentiful in 1980, rather less so in 1981, and in August this year, they've been no more than normal, and it may therefore be that Comet Swift Tuttle has been and gone unseen. It may be picked up yet, but I'm getting rather doubtful, and of course, with comets, one can never tell. Comets are certainly in the news, partly because of Halley, of course, but also partly because of a new and quite revolutionary theory put forward by two distinguished astronomers at the Royal Observatory, Edinburgh, Drs. Victor Clube and Bill Napier. More about that shortly. But first of all, a few words about comets themselves. They are not solid, rocky bodies like planets. A great comet has a head or coma and a long, possibly curved tail. And Donati's comet of 1858 is supposed to have been just about the most beautiful ever seen, although not actually the brightest. But that was an exception, and most comets are very much less spectacular than that. Here, for example, is a photograph I took some time ago of a comet called Kilstone's comet. And that looks like a small fuzz, and there's no semblance there of a tail. And many small comets just do not have tails. And that one, Kilstone's comet, again, is what we call non-periodical. In other words, it won't be back for a great many centuries. All the great comets have very drawn-out orbits, but some are smaller comets which can be seen regularly. These are the so-called periodical comets. And here are three typical examples. Encke's comet. Now, that has a period of only just over 3 years. It comes back regularly. It's now been seen at over 50 different returns. It's never visible with the naked eye, but it's an old friend. Then we have Crommelin's comet, and that has a period of over 27 years, and that's due back again in 1983. And then, of course, Halley's comet, with a period of 76 years, which has been seen regularly ever since well before the time of Christ. But Halley's is the exception. It's the only bright comet that we can predict. All the other really brilliant comets have periods so long, they come back only once in thousands or even millions of years, so we never know when to expect them, and they tend to take us by surprise. And that is why Halley is so important, and we hope to get several probes to it during the coming return. But what about the nature of comets? Where do they come from? According to a theory put forward by the Dutch astronomer Jan Oort, and I think accepted by most authorities, there's a cloud of comets orbiting the Sun at a distance of about one light year. That's roughly one quarter of the distance between the Sun and the nearest stars, those of the triple Alpha Centauri system. Obviously, comets moving in the Oort cloud are so far away from us that there's no chance whatever of our seeing them. But now and then, one of the comets in the Oort cloud may be perturbed for some reason. It will then start to fall in toward the Sun. It may just go straight out again. On the other hand, it may pass fairly close to one of the planets, generally Jupiter, which of course is much the most massive planet, and its orbit may be completely altered. Because a comet is a very low mass compared with the planet, and whereas the planet can affect the comet very seriously, the comet can have no measurable effects upon the planet. And it may easily happen that the comet coming in from the Oort cloud is diverted into a much smaller orbit and becomes a periodical comet. And this again has strange effects. Because remember, a comet is made up very largely of ices. Every time it goes in towards perihelion, that's to say it's closest to the Sun, those ices become heated and they start to evaporate and they form the coma and the tail. And so the comet loses a certain amount of material every time it comes back to the Sun. And a periodical comet, coming back once every 10, 20 or 30 years, suffers a steady wastage of mass. And that can't go on forever. Well, now we come to theory, not entirely supported by all branches of observation, but very serious theory nonetheless. It is suggested that when a periodical comet has made sufficient return to the Sun, it loses all its gas and dust, and all you're left with is the cold, dead nucleus, a dead comet which may be an Apollo asteroid. Now, the asteroids, or the big ones, they keep to the area between the orbits of Mars and Jupiter, and some of them are quite big. Ceres is over 600 miles in diameter. They're quite different. They're almost certainly debris left over when the main solar system was formed. But there are also much smaller asteroids, known as the Apollos, after the best member of the class, which have more eccentric orbits. They can come into the inner part of the solar system, and they may even pass close to the Earth. They are all very small, so they're not bright. But they show up all right. And there's a picture of one of them, Icarus. It's that trail in the middle of the picture there. It trailed across the plate at the time the explosion was being made, because it moves quite quickly. And that has a strange path, which carries it inside the orbit of the innermost planet, Mercury. And at its perihelion, Icarus is only about 16 million miles from the Sun, and then it must be red hot. And it's quite widely supposed now that the Apollo asteroids, Icarus and its kind, are nothing more nor less than dead comets. And this is where we start coming to the new theories of Drs. Clube and Napier. Now remember, we live in a spiral galaxy, and there are times when the Sun, together with all its planets, goes through one of the spiral arms. It has been supposed that the Oort cloud of comets has existed since almost the birth of the solar system. But Clube and Napier suppose that every time the Sun goes through a spiral arm, the Oort cloud is renewed. Many of the old comets are lost, and new ones are collected. And that means that every time we come out of a spiral arm, we are left with an excess of comets. And there's a period of several millions of years when the solar system contains more than its average number of comets. Now, if these do turn into Apollo asteroids, there's always a chance of collision with the Earth. And there are quite strong pieces of evidence that these collisions have occurred in past times. And a collision with an Apollo asteroid a few miles in diameter would be disastrous in every sense of the term. Now, look back for a moment at the dinosaurs. Now, they disappeared quite suddenly after having ruled the Earth for a very long time, about 65 million years ago. There was nothing gradual about it. The dinosaurs suddenly disappeared. And could this have been due to climatic changes caused by the collision of an Apollo-type asteroid with the Earth? Many people think so. And there's interesting evidence gathered from the fact that these things could presumably bring with them the element iridium. And if you delve down in the Earth's rocks and come to strata laid down 65 million years ago, you find more iridium than you'd expect. Could this be evidence of a past Apollo-type collision? It could well be so. But let's come on now to near-historical times. And Clube and Napier suggest that in those near-historical times, there was a vast, terrifying comet dominating the sky, and this was accompanied by collisions with Apollo-type asteroids. And they call this comet the Cosmic Serpent. It certainly is a very revolutionary theory. It's quite unorthodox, but it's fascinating. And we are delighted to have Dr. Victor Clube with us now. Welcome to the Sky at Night, Victor.
Good evening, Patrick.
Well, you described this theory at the last meeting of the International Astronomical Union. How was it received?
Well, the theory may well be unorthodox, but today's heresy is often tomorrow's truth, and the evidence is currently moving our way. It certainly looks now as if we get a new Oort cloud each time we pass through a spiral arm, and this idea was generally well received at the meeting.
Yes, I remember that. Well, what happens when the solar system gets a new Oort cloud?
Well, each new Oort cloud produces roughly 1,000 new Apollos. Between spiral arm passages, this family of Apollos diminishes. Close encounters with planets drive some of them away, and others actually collide, producing large craters like those that we see on the Moon.
Alphonsus, over 80 miles in diameter. But on the impact theory, most of these craters were produced when the solar system was young, thousands of millions of years ago.
Well, so they were, but then the cratering rate declined, as you see in this graph. Eventually, the rate leveled out, and most of the craters are now due to comets captured from spiral arms. Each little peak that you see in this graph corresponds to a new episode of cratering produced by a new Oort cloud coming at something like 100 million year intervals.
What exactly happens during a period of intense cratering?
Well, in the first 30 million years or so, there are enough big Apollos striking the Earth to reverse the magnetic field about 30 times and to trigger many periods of glaciation. Such periods of glaciation would correspond to an ice age in the geological record. Each episode also produces about one really large Apollo, 10 to 20 kilometers or so in diameter, whose impact is so energetic it can virtually wipe out life on Earth in one go, not to mention pushing around the continents and causing worldwide volcanic activity. The effects produced by each large Apollo are roughly those you would associate with simultaneously releasing about 1,000 million hydrogen bombs, one to every square kilometer, if you like, of the Earth's surface. An event really of unimaginable ferocity, and compared to which nuclear war is a mere trifle.
It would indeed be so. So you think then that these intense cratering periods are accompanied by extinctions and with reversals of the Earth's magnetic field?
Yes, this is an important prediction of our theory, and it shows up well in the geological record, especially at the Permo-Triassic and Cretaceous-Tertiary boundaries. Where in this diagram you see many stripes, this corresponds to the field changing rapidly, and you can see that these coincide with the two most important extinctions. Actually, it's interesting to think that if the dinosaurs could have measured magnetic fields, They might have seen their own extinction coming.
Wouldn't have done them much good.
All of this has an effect on the evolution of life generally. It is no longer a very smooth process. After each major catastrophe, indeed other catastrophes, there would be rapid evolution as the surviving species seek to adjust to the new environment. But in due course, things settle down and evolution proceeds a little more gently. That is until the next catastrophe. Obviously, evolution is set back each time, but we would see a sequence of what you could call punctuated equilibria, just what the paleontologists now claim they are seeing.
So what you're really doing is to use all branches of science to show that what happens on the Earth is really controlled by what's happening in the galaxy. But I'm very interested in your views about comets. Most astronomers have always supposed that they are genuine members of the solar system, but you think that they are interstellar and are picked up by the sun.
Yes, well, stars and comets are made together, we believe, and we know new stars are born in spiral arms. So it's quite reasonable to capture very many comets as we go through spiral arms. At the moment, of course, we're not in a spiral arm, so we don't expect to see interstellar comets tracking their way through the solar system in open orbits. What we do observe are a lot of comets in closed orbits, belonging to the Oort cloud, which was actually captured when we last went through a spiral arm, and this was about 10 million years ago.
Well, does that mean that we are now, at this moment, in an age of ice periods and magnetic reversals, with possibly a new extinction on the way?
Yes, we think this is very likely. Indeed, more than that, in 1978, astronomers discovered a 10-kilometer asteroid, which is now called Hephaestus, in a potentially Earth-crossing orbit. We believe now that the Earth may already have had one or two close encounters, fairly close encounters, with Hephaestus.
Can you be confident about that, then?
Well, Hephaestus has an orbit which is just like that of Encke's comet and the Beta Torrid meteor stream.
True.
Many years ago, the American astronomer Fred Whipple showed that Encke's comet and the Beta Torrids probably broke away from another body during the third millennium BC.
Yes.
It now looks very much as if Hephaestus was that other body. And if so, there was a truly very large comet captured into an Earth-crossing orbit at this time. Okay, so we deduce from the modern sky that the ancient sky was entirely different. Not only was there this huge, terrifying comet that from time to time came close to the Earth, there was also a huge meteor stream producing an extremely vivid zodiacal light and gegenschein. The early Egyptians actually portrayed the zodiacal light as a luminous pyramid in the sky. And for 1,000 years or so, at the right season, viewers of the night sky would have seen two bright pillars of light stretching up along the ecliptic.
Well, it certainly would have been spectacular. But it's the comet itself that you call the cosmic serpent, isn't it?
That is so. Close to the Earth, it may have been as bright as the moon, with a tail that stretched right across the sky. There would also have been regular annual or biannual encounters with the meteor stream, producing almost certainly vivid fireball displays and undoubtedly shooting stars in their thousands.
Well, even today we have magnificent meteor showers. I suppose the greatest of modern times, or near modern times, was the Leonid shower of 1833, but there was another very good one in 1966. Do you think that the ancient showers were more intense than that?
Oh, I think it's very almost certain that they were. Indeed, there would from time to time have been encounters with quite large bodies, 100 meters or so, and these would have produced Tunguska like events, in fact, explosions with quite terrifying consequences.
Well, the Tunguska event is something quite out of the ordinary. In 1908, something fell in Siberia and blew pine trees flat over a radius of 50 kilometers. But that could have been a part of Encke's comet.
Yes, that is so, and we feel certain now it was experiences of this kind at this time that led to mankind's age-old fear of the comets. We often make fun of this idea nowadays, yes. But comets were known to produce disasters on Earth. Even the word disaster actually means literally evil star. Hmm. Another thing of interest is that the same phenomena probably also led to the ancient fear of eclipses. In this diagram here, you can see that the densest part of the meteor stream, if it was lined up with the Earth and the Sun, may well have dimmed the Sun, and man would have known that the probability of a serious encounter with the Earth in the near future was then at its greatest. The ancient Greeks, it is interesting, for example, spoke of eclipses that lasted for a month. And This is a fact that has proved quite incomprehensible until our theory came along.
True.
Even in 800 AD, Chinese astrologers were still looking out for high-level clouds that dimmed the face of the sun.
Well, generally speaking, do you think that the ancient records go along with your theory?
Well, early in the first millennium BC, the cosmic serpent began to disappear from sight, but its orbit was regular, and the ancients discovered the trick of using planets to mark its course. That was when modern astronomy really began.
Yes.
Before that, astronomy was all to do with comets and gods in the sky.